Okay, this is our first day about COVID-19 disease in Italy, and especially in pregnancy. I said that I'm Fabrizio, I am an anesthetist, especially an obstetric anesthetist, and I work here in Padua. We have 3,000 deliveries every year. And I spend all my time in delivery room. The aims of the course is to explain how to organize the maternity ward. Probably now is very interest for you. Our experience with pregnant women and newborns. And the next day, we talk about the experience and treatment of major obstetric emergency. We will use learning video in the second day and some multiple choice question. Please, possible, put your webcam always on and microphone off except during the question and discussion. So, the first day about COVID-19, because for us it was a really tsunami, especially in the beginning of March. So, we had a lot of cases in a very few days. So we organized our maternity ward in very few days. What was the story of the virus? It started in November 19, and then we had some hot points. The first was the human-to-human transmission, and the other was the symptomatic individuals carrying the virus with other people with minor symptoms. So it was a very big problem because a lot of people without symptoms can carry the virus to the other people. And what has happened in Italy? This was our epidemiological curve. We had a peak in 21 of March, and then the curve was stabilized, but we aren't out now of this problem. We are in Veneto, that it was the first countries of Italy affected. But if you see, there is a little bit geographical bias because the town of Piacenza, inside the most huge focolaio, was the third region. Probably we are the third region because Piacenza is inside Lombardia focolaio. What's happened during pregnancy? Luckily, a large majority of women will experience only mild or moderate cold flu with only cough and fever. More severe symptoms like pneumonia or respiratory disease could occur rarely in pregnant women. And this is a very interesting report on 27 of April. You see that infected people, COVID-19 infected people, condition present are very, very low. Pregnancy is less present instead of other condition. And it's interesting to see that other immunodeficiency disease are less present than others. For example, AIDS and hematological disease or malignant neoplasia are less present than other like diabetes or chronic cardiac disease. So pregnancy luckily is a very low condition present with the infection of COVID-19. This was a very scary publication. In fact, we all three used this publication.
Ho dimenticato di dirti che alle 6:30 ho appuntamento con il
dottore. In the beginning of March, poi di settimana.
Quindi arriverò tardi.
In March, we have this report from New York on 215 pregnant women. 13.5% was asymptomatic positive. It was a very scary number because a lot of pregnant women had the virus but hadn't symptoms. So you can find these pregnant women in during disactivity, we couldn't find these pregnant women without a swab because they hadn't seen them. At the beginning of March, this publication on Lancet was very, very helpful. And here we divided the pregnant women into groups, asymptomatic and symptomatic. When a pregnant woman arrived to the delivery, you have to make a swab, and then waiting the result, you can divide in asymptomatic and symptomatic. Asymptomatic doesn't need an isolation room, but it's important to monitoring at home if it's during pregnancy or in hospital if it's near the labor. Then, when you have the result of swabs, you divide in negative, you can stop monitoring at home, or positive. So you can have an asymptomatic positive pregnant woman. What you should do? You should isolate at home for 14 days. If delivery is near, it's important. I don't know if now it's indicated to avoid breastfeeding. You can talk about breastfeeding with Daniele in the presentation about newborn. But it's important to isolate the mother in an isolation room. For symptomatic people with fever more than 38 degrees and respiratory symptom, it's important monitoring at hospital. And then if swab is positive, you have to bring her in a tertiary care center hospital. Or if it's negative, you can isolation at home for 14 days and repeat the swab after 48 hours. If she's symptomatic positive, it's important to have an intensive neonatal intensive care and an intensive care unit for the mother if it's necessary. Then Arianna will talk you the timing of delivery in presence of COVID-19 infection. Okay, what about the isolation room? The patient for us have to wear a surgical face mask. Surgical mask is enough for a pregnant woman and for the staff. If it's impossible, for example, during labor, the second stage of labor, it's very, very difficult that pregnant woman can wear a surgical face mask. The staff have to wear a FFP2 mask, okay? So it's important to choose the mask in different cases. Either isolation room as an antechamber for donning and doffing the PPE, and if it's possible, to have a private bathroom and a negative pressure room. What about the advices of World Health Organization about pregnant women with COVID-19, confirmed COVID-19 infection? Remember that a pillar of our specialization is pain relief. So now we talk about pain relief strategies during a COVID-19 infection. I hope that you in your hospital have a lot of epidural or spinal analgesia for your pregnant woman. We have more or less 45% of delivery in analgesia, and we prefer epidural analgesia. So, what about labor analgesia in COVID-19 infection? There is no evidence that epidural or spinal analgesia is contraindicated, so you can do an inguinal block as a normal. Only one advice is to perform a platelet count some hour before the neuraxial block, because during the infection of COVID-19, you can develop the thrombocytopenia. So it's important to have a platelet count near the position of neuraxial block. and epidural analgesia is too strongly recommended because it could avoid a general anesthesia, because in this patient we have to avoid general anesthesia. Entonox, it's useful in United Kingdom. We don't use Entonox, but with disinfection, with droplet transmission, it's better avoid Entonox and use other types of analgesia like neuraxial analgesia, that is the best for pregnant women. And what about cesarean section? For the anesthesia of cesarean section, we have to perform the spinal or epidural anesthesia, so always neuraxial block, and avoid general anesthesia unless absolutely necessary for the problem of intubation and difficult airways in obstetric women, and for the transmission of virus from droplets. So if it's important to make a general anesthesia, please donning PPE, and donning PPE is mandatory and you can waste a lot of time. So if you have a C-section of category one, so a radical section, you have to talk about with women and with their families about the waste of time to donning PPE. So you can do the cesarean section in 15 minutes probably. So it's important to talk about of this waste of time. Then if general anesthesia is important, you can use a rapid sequences induction and not use high flow cannula for pre-oxygenation. And for intubation is indicated to use video laryngoscopy directly, and don't ventilate the patient until the cuff inflection. If you have a difficult airway, a difficult intubation, you have to use a second generation supraglottid airways. And if you are very, very, very unlucky, you have to perform a FONA, scalpel boogie tube, like tracheostomy. It's important to have two pair of gloves, and the second, you have to remove the first pair after the intubation. The position of the tube is important to determine without auscultation, but with chest wall expansion and with CO2 waveform. So don't use the auscultation for the position of the tube. And remember that extubation is a high risk procedure, so it's important to have to minimize the number of staff in the room. So you have to two or three persons in the room. An anesthetist and a nurse of anesthetist is enough, because you have to a lot of spread of virus during extubation. And this is our idea of for ventilation of a patient of COVID-19 positive. You can use this plastic surface so you can block the droplets. And now we'll see a video about donning and doffing PPE. Thank you. So, have you ever seen it's very, very long procedure to donning PPE. So it's very, very important for your safety to donning PPE first. And no problem, any problem for a C-section red code category one C-section, because you have to donning PPE for your safety. It's mandatory, okay? Do you have any question?
Did you do training to learn how to put your PPE properly?
Yes, we did a lot of simulation with time recording. And after 2-3 simulation, we do it in 2-3 minutes. So, and it's most important doffing PPE because you are infected than donning. Donning, you can put mask before the surgical cap or other, but then during doffing, you have to see with another people that you doffing in the right way. But with simulation, we donning PPE in 2-3 minutes.
Thank you.
This is our first case, a pregnant woman, 28 years old, hospitalized from 13 of March at the Department of Infection Disease of our hospital in Padua for respiratory failure in SARS-CoV-2 pneumonia in pregnancy, 25 gestational age. In her medical history, he had a familial thrombophilia and a previously deep venous thrombosis that it's not good with the COVID-19 infection because COVID-19 infection had a prothrombotic, have a prothrombotic status. So she had a very high risk of embolisms. She was in therapy with enoxaparin. She had her first symptom on 9th of March and she went to a secondary hospital for fever and cough. And she performed a pharyngeal and nasal swab positive for 19 COVID infection. But her gynecological examination was normal, so she was discharged, like in the flowchart of Lancet, she was discharged and isolated at home. Then after 4 days, more or less, she had a worsening of her symptoms. And the temperature arrived to 40 degrees, not treatable with drugs. So she was hospitalized at the Department of Infectious Disease of our hospital. So like in the flowchart of Lancet, in the tertiary center hospital. She started oxygen therapy with a gold standard saturation more than 94-95, because it's important for the neonatal oxygen. And she started antiviral therapy with lopinavir and ritonavir and antibacterial therapy with meropenem. So, what you do next in this case? I'll copy on the chat this link. It's a little bit question, multiple choice question. Okay, now I have set 8 answers and 50% pulmonary echography, 12 all of above, and 37 chest radiography. So I share the screen, one moment. It's more difficult on web than in present. Okay, we started with a chest radiography that it wasn't so bad, but we performed a pulmonary echography too with a bilateral pulmonary interstitial disease and another pharyngeal and nasal swab. That surprise was negative. But nevertheless, the negative swab on 14th of March, she had a worsening of dyspnea and oxygen saturation. We put the Venturi mask, 40% of oxygen, and she was transferred to ICU. These were her parameters, 96 of saturation. And this was her blood gas analysis with PaO2 78. and CO228. But our gynecologist decided to perform a cesarean section that night, so on 25 and some days of gestational age. We performed that cesarean section in general anesthesia. Luckily, we hadn't any troubles with intubation. We performed a rapid sequence induction with propofol, fentanyl, and rocuronium. We hadn't any problem with the saturation or mechanical ventilation. And then we transferred the pregnant woman intubated into the ICU. And a few minutes after midnight, Alessandro, her baby, was born. What's happened in ICU? She was extubated the next morning and treated with high flow cannula. Discharged to the infection disease department the next day too, on 16th of March. And then on 12th of March, after two negative swabs, she returned to home. On 28th of May, she returned to our hospital to perform another control swabs. And she did the antibodies too for coronavirus, because the second swab was negative. So she had the first swab positive to another hospital and the second swab negative to our hospital. So we had a lot of problems because we didn't know what was true. And the solution was that she had a coronavirus disease because her antibodies IgG was positive after two months more or less. And this is an happy ending story because she was the first delivery in Italy for a woman with COVID-19 infection, especially with a cesarean section. So she was the first Italian cesarean section with COVID-19 infection. Question about this case?
And the baby was well?
Daniele will talk about the baby because we had the same case, but we are divided the specialization. So we talk about anesthesia. Arianna will talk about the gynecologist. Vuoi dire qualcosa? Okay. And Daniele will talk about the baby. It's an happy ending story.
But in terms of course, it was a learning curve, and this is why your experience is so valuable to us. And we wanted to record these videos to make them available for doctors working in other hospitals that don't have access now. Because you told us about the spinal anesthesia, and you recommend that we use the spinal anesthesia now for these cases. However, then I imagine because it was a new case and, about the general anesthesia, if you want to comment on that, the choice.
So it was the first case of Italy, and it was beginning of March. And the decision of delivery and the anesthesia too was a lot of human factors. So we was scary. We didn't know anything about this virus, the transmission to the baby. We had only Chinese reports, no study, no meta-analysis. We hadn't anything. So it was very, very scary case, because it was the first case in Italy of delivery.
And thank you very much.
I recommended too the epidural analgesia in this pregnant women, because you can improve her respiratory system, her cardiovascular system, and to use the epidural catheter to have a cesarean section, emergency cesarean section. So you can avoid general anesthesia if you have an epidural catheter. So it's important to put the epidural catheter in this patient for analgesia or for anesthesia.
And one more question, if you want to comment on I mean, we had a case here, 27 weeks pregnant woman with worsening dyspnea, not in our hospital, in another hospital, but they decided to deliver her because it's, you know, with our experience, with other causes of dyspnea in pregnancy, you need to deliver to improve. You have the impression that by delivering the baby, you will improve the symptoms and the pulmonary function. Does it work the same for the coronavirus?
It can be possible, but 25, like us, or 26 gestational age, is a very, very low age to have displays of pulmonary up. So probably have to improve non-invasive ventilation first. We had last 2-3 years ago a pregnant woman with H1N1 influenza, and we treated her with ECMO when she was pregnant. We didn't make the delivery in that case. It was very, very bad. She was in ICU and she was with ECMO, and we wait for the cesarean section because she was at 28 gestational age. So probably you can't improve the pulmonary respiration because now probably the virus attacked the vessels, not the pulmonary interstitium. So it's a infection of the vessels. In fact, you have a lot of organs involved. Lungs, heart, and kidneys too. So it's a multi-organ failure. It's not a pulmonary infection, like bacterial infection. So it's a little bit different. The treatment and the improvement of respiration with delivery. So probably we have to use a non-invasive ventilation first and then perform the cesarean section if it's necessary, if you haven't an improvement.
Thank you.
So, okay, this is the second case. A pregnant woman, 40 years old, hospitalizes in 13 of March, so the same days of the first, for piperomy placenta creta, waiting for a C-section. She hadn't a medical history, interesting medical history. She had only a tiroidectomy and no allergies. But during hospitalization, waiting for C-section, she developed the fever until 38 degrees with cough. So we performed the isolation room, blood exam, hemoculture, uroculture, and all respiratory virus and bacteria. Obviously, coronavirus swabs too. Then, waiting for results, she developed the dyspnea, tachypnea, and the saturation until 94% in ambient air, 96 with a little bit of oxygen. Temperature was high, 38 degrees. And these were her exons and her blood exon with PaO2 76, PCO2 24. It's very, very similar to the first case. Blood exam was more or less normal because 17 white cell in pregnancy is normal. So we performed the X-ray first, and this was the result. So we were very, very scared. And the first thing was, oh my God, it's another coronavirus disease case in a few days. It's the same day because it was 15 of March. So here we have another question for you on the chat. Okay. So your answers are very interesting. The first question was, do you think that symptom and X-ray are suggested? And 43% said maybe, 43% yes, and for 14 no. But in more interest, the most likely diagnosis. 57 said COVID-19, 14 bacterial pneumonia, and 28 pulmonary embolism. So because we know that we have a big problem with fever in pregnancy, probably the large majority of pregnant women have fever during pregnancy or during labor too. So 38 degrees is more or less normal during labor. In this time, have this fever, it's very, very problem because everybody think COVID-19 disease. So we continue with the presentation. Okay. So we had a lot of differential diagnosis of fever, COVID-19 pneumonia, embolism, edema, bacterial pneumonia, other cardiovascular disease or sepsis, for example, for a chorioamnionitis because she had a ruptured membrane. So we performed echocardiography first and it was normal with a low risk for pulmonary hypertension and embolism. Then we performed a lot of swabs, the COVID swabs, but other bacteria swabs, Legionella, Streptococcus, etc. This was total negative. Then on 16 of March, we had a pneumological infectiological consultation, and so she started antibacterial drugs with meropenem and azithromycin. The second swab was performed and it was negative for COVID-19 disease. And we started to have a clinical improvement with the facial mask. The temperature was lower, 37 degrees, and her arterial blood analysis improved. Then on 17th of March, her blood exam was improved, but our gynecologist decided for cesarean section because she had a placenta creta and a PPROM. In this case, we performed a spinal anesthesia for the cesarean section. This case, clinically, it's very similar to the other. But in the first, we had a swab positive. In this case, we hadn't a positive swab. This was her chest ray on 19th of March. She had a very, very good improvement. And in 23rd of March, she was completely normal. So very good. But it is the end of this case. Probably not, because we had a doubt about her infection. She had an infection or not. So we performed in this case the antibodies and it was negative. So she hadn't a COVID-19 pneumonia. Probably she had a bacterial pneumonia, but we didn't isolate the bacteria. So what are the take-home message of this presentation? That every hospital must have an internal protocol based on national guidelines and recommendation, especially now if you have an increase of the cases every day. Not all fever or the saturation are COVID-19 disease, so remember always the other differential diagnosis, embolism, edema, or other sepsis, or other pneumonia. Peridural analgesia, please, is recommended. And for cesarean section, prefer neuraxial block. And at the end, simulation training will improve your team working. the time of donning and offing PPE, and to improve the time to make the cesarean section. So this is our phrase about this problem, that if you can smile with your mouth, you can smile with your eyes because you have a lot of surgical masks. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can we ask some questions, general questions now?
Okay.
I will start with a question that I have, and I do you give Clexane or thromboprophylaxis while pregnant and after delivery? And if you do, how long for the confirmed cases?
Okay. With a COVID infection, probably Arianna can answer this question. But for Clexane, probably first the delivery, not then delivery. Because, yes, you have a prothrombotic status, but you can, if the woman is asymptomatic, she can work the day after the cesarean section. And you can use other, for example, calzelastic. I don't know the
compressive socks. Yeah, okay.
Calzelastica. So you can use this. You can work the woman, so you can have a low risk of embolism after delivery. Before the delivery, probably during the infection, you can give Clexane 1 week, because if you make Clexane, if the women take Clexane, you can perform the spinal anesthesia in a few hours. You have to have 12 hours if you have one dose of Clexane, and if you have two doses of Clexane, you have to attend 24 hours for a neuraxial block. So it's a little bit pro and cons. It's more important to perform a neuraxial block that give a Clexane, in my opinion, because you can intubate the women, so you haven't problem.
Thank you.
Good afternoon to everybody. I start with my presentation. I'm the gynecologist. See, I want to change the PowerPoint. Sorry.
Okay.
We start to have our positive patients on 21st of February, and in particular, we have the first man in Milan and the first did here in our city in Padova. And after that, we have a spread of outbreak till the 11th of March, when our first minister, Giuseppe Conte, decided to put the whole nation in the lockdown. Because what did we see? We see our intensive care units overflowed. We didn't know where to host our positive patients. We had a crematorium worked 24 hours a day, and a long waiting list for funeral services. So probably you have saw our military trucks with our DID. This was really impressive and strong to live. The 28th of February, our sanitary health system, coordinating a surveillance system, integrating the microbiological and epidemiological data to check the progression of the outbreak, the pandemic. And in that time, what we knew, We know, we thought that pregnancy is a physiological state that predispose to viral respiratory infections. And so we expected a disaster in obstetric because maternal immune system to favor the growing of the fetus works less than general population. So we expected a big number of obstetric pregnant in the hospital. More, what do we know about the previous pandemic? We knew that in the United States we had more than 100 deaths, maternal deaths during H1N1 pandemic. So really we were very afraid of the situation that we have to live, and also because we didn't have in that time many informations from China. We knew this, we knew that when we compare the seasonal flu with COVID-19, we have the R0 number. R0 number is the estimate of how many people will be infected by an average individual with the disease. So it was higher in COVID-19, 2.5 against 1.3 in the flu. The incubation time was higher in COVID-19, you know, 1 till 14 days to show the infection, the symptoms. Against 1 till 4 days in the flu. Also, the hospitalization rate was higher with COVID-19 in the general population, I mean, and the case fatality rate was higher. So the stress of our stress was very high. Also because when we start to have the first cases, we have a lot of cases and we weren't prepared to that. We had the WHO advices in the for delivering patients. So they advise to us the respect, the dignity, the companion for patients during labor, the clear communication, but we hadn't clear ideas. Okay, the pain relief strategies, the mobility in labor, but for us it was very complicated. The Royal College advised also to permit to the partner to stay in the delivery room with the mother, with the woman, actually we in the first months can't allow to the partner to enter. Then we change our position, but in the start it was only to preserve women and babies. So we decided in 2 days to start with the triage areas, and we have nurse that check temperature in the enter of our hospital, and she did question about the symptom, and the visitors were limited. We also started with nasal swab, and then we will see. The PPE that we used in the delivery room, we had a very confusion in the start because we obtained the FFP2 masks, but not a lot. So in the first days, we were very afraid, scary. So all our midwives use the FFP2, but then we have to change because we didn't have a lot of the personal protective equipment, not for all. So we have to change, and we use surgical mask. And apart in the case where we had patients positive or with doubt of a positive test or with the presence of symptoms. Also because in that week, in those weeks, we for us it was also difficult to have results of the swab in a few hours because we had a lot of tests to check. So sometimes we ask to have the results today and the answer will come tomorrow. So we treated patients as positive, even if she weren't. So we asked also if, because for all women, we decided to use a mask, surgical mask, also during expulsion stage, and obstetrics too used a mask, as I told before. So in the first months, father wasn't there, but then he started to enter because we started to check the nasal swab in men and women. These are what the health sanitary system, Italian health sanitary system, told us. It was the 1 week after the first case. They told us that pregnant women are considered a population at risk, as I told you before, and that we had to recommend primary prevention actions in these women. I mean, accurate hand hygiene and attention to avoid contact, but I remember that from the 11th of March we had a complete lockdown, so we cannot go out, we cannot meet our parents, we cannot run, we have to stay at home. And a lot of people stay at home also, it's stopped with the work. We have a smart work, as probably you did. So that was the situation. They advised to isolation mother and or newborn in case of suspicion. We didn't have information about the susceptibility of pregnant women to the SARS-CoV, so probably they told us probably they are at risk, but we didn't know. We don't know. And we didn't know about the vertical transmission. In that moment, they didn't advise to us to perform cesarean section, but they advised to discuss in multidisciplinary way to decide and consider maternal and fetal clinical conditions. And about the breastfeeding, we didn't know. What was best, but it seemed that the coronavirus was not detected in breast milk. So it was important to try to organize the breastfeeding in case of positive patients to avoid the contact between mother and newborn. On 25th of March, our health sanitary system launched an observational cohort study to check the spread of the infection in the obstetric women, and the results just published last week, I think it was published, where the results were that the incident rate of infection in women was 2% in 1,000 maternities at a national level and 6.9 per 1,000 in Lombardy region. Because probably you know that the big load of our death and infections was in Lombardy. I mean the region where we have Milan and Bergamo. Overall, 1/3 of the women developed pneumonia, and cesarean section rate was 32.9%. So it was high. I think we had a high percentage of cesarean section because we didn't know what could happen in that women and that fetus. So the conclusions was that the clinical features and the outcome of COVID-19 in women who gave birth are similar to those described for the general population. So not worse as we expected. And most women developing mild to moderate illness, so not very severe. Then we had several data, CDC, we had also Royal College and a lot of other data in which there was not found evidence that pregnant women were more susceptible to infection. And there were no more prone to the general population to developing severe pneumonia. The most common symptoms that the women, pregnant women presented were fever and cough. This is something that Fabrizia has already shown. Is the published data from New York and Columbia University. They have a lot of asymptomatic patients and a little number of symptomatic patients. And these are our numbers. We had, we performed in 3 months, 757 swab, nasal swab in women, and negative. And we had only seven positive, in which only two patients were symptomatic. In this period, we had patient with symptom, but we were not able to find, as we saw later, we find a positive swab. So sometime probably it was a coronavirus, but sometime maybe we couldn't find, or we had positive and negative. So I think we had to check and then to think about the clinic of the patients also. I joined this those PowerPoint because we had a change of our thought in the vertical transmissions. These are the recent articles. We found in the placenta and membrane swabs positive presence of coronavirus. So we start to think that vertical transmission is possible. And as the coronavirus utilizes the angiotensin converting enzyme receptor and the serine protease for cell entry, there is this study where the expressions of this receptor is present in the placenta, but minimally expressed. The expression is minimally. So that seems to show that is possible, the transmission, the vertical transmission. We also had this recent study, it's the 14th of July, published on Nature Communications, and this is nice because it's a case of women 33 years old, first pregnancy, and she were admitted in March at 35 weeks of gestation with fever, high fever, 38.6, cough, expectoration since 2 days before. The exam showed thrombocytopenia, lymphopenia, transaminitis, and elevated PCR and ferritin. She had this cardiotocography, so a category 3 with fetal tachycardia, little, because it's 160, late deceleration and reduce variability. So they perform cesarean section 30 minutes after this that you can see in records. And the Apgar score was 4-2-7. And the newborn had a face mask with non-invasive ventilation in the first 5 minutes of life, and then intubation and invasive ventilation. They were able to show that there was a maternal viremia, placental infection, demonstrated by the immunohistochemistry, and very high viral load, placental inflammation, and neonatal viremia following placental infection, probably. So this was a case of vertical transmission. What about the general treatment of our patient? It's important to maintain fluid and electrolyte balance. And we have to to give symptomatic treatment such paracetamol or antidiarrheal medicines. About maternal surveillance, monitoring of vital signs and oxygen saturation, and arterial blood gas analysis, repeat chest imaging if indicated, and regular blood exams to check complete blood count, renal and liver function test, and coagulation test. About the fetal surveillance, cardiotocography to check fetal heart rate, and ultrasound if possible, because for example, for us, it was hard to perform ultrasound because when we had two symptomatic cases, the patient, the positive patient were not in our ward. And so she was in another place where ultrasound was not used. In the case of mild disease, it's important the same thing, but then moreover, it's important talk about virologists and the other colleagues to consider antiviral treatment, if antiviral treatment could improve the symptoms of patients, because we can have a risk of fetal growth restriction with these drugs. And obviously monitoring the bacterial infections and consider to use antibiotics. Food the fetal is the same as before. In case of severe and critical disease, where the severe pneumonia or multiple organ failure is present, it's important to transfer patient in intensive care unit where she needs support of multidisciplinary team, consider treatment with antibiotics, maintain appropriate blood pressure and fluid balance, give oxygen in a way in which anesthesiologist can advise to us greater than 95%. Consider to give to these patients heparin, low molecular weight heparin, in case ever, because we learned that in this infection we had a problem with vessel with the coagulation, and were indicated and this is a decision that should that should have been taken from different specialists, considered the preterm delivery, considering the gestational week, considering the clinical of patients, and how patients is going. And what we are we doing with in our world for these patients, but obviously the prevention. So we try to maintain social distancing with our patients, outpatients, or and obviously with the admitted patients. No support person to accompany patients to the visit. We have designated separated areas in each unit for positive patients or symptomatic patients without a diagnosis, with the diagnosis on works. We increase sanitizations and sanitizer available at front desk or out of the rooms. Wipe down patient's room after each patient and wipe down waiting area chairs frequently. Symptomatic patients who arrive to our hospital or in our office are managed as if they are positive, so isolated in designated areas, so we change place with appropriate mask and PPE. Also for us. All of our patients, pregnant patients, have a nasal swab at 39 weeks, also to the partners. And if they came to the emergency room, for example, 37 weeks, we performed the nasal swab in emergency room. Now we have, in a few hours, the results. A partner positive doesn't enter to the delivery room, to the hospital, really. And this is the case that I reported. It's not a case probably of coronavirus, but we have this patient in the early weeks of starting spread of the virus. It was 21st of February. She was a patient of 49, an egg donation. She was 33 and 5 day week gestation. This was the first pregnancy, and she had a urgent admission for increased blood pressures. She had an hip hypertension. We say gestational, but probably it was pre-gestational hypertension, because the diagnosis was from 12 gestational week. The fetal shown in the ultrasound of 5 months an interventricular septum hyperechogenicity, but the women decide to do not perform amniocentesis to check if there were a problem with the chromosomes. She had a previous epilepsy, and she take aspirin and methyldopa. The ultrasound was regular, and the cardiotocography also was regular. So she had the corticosteroids for fetal maturation, and a second ultrasound show, because we didn't check the biometry, the fetal biometry in the emergency room. So she had an ultrasound during the admission, and she had a fetal growth restriction. And she stayed admitted 3 weeks, if I well remember, because she needed to to check the therapy, because before she had high pressure, then she had a very low pressure. She didn't feel well, so we are not able to discharge the patients. And finally, she had a cesarean section, an elective cesarean section at 37 gestational weeks. So we can consider that she had a long admission during the first weeks of March, in which we have a lot of fever patients and also positive patients. After the cesarean section, she had a postpartum hemorrhage, and she had a curettage and intrauterine Bakri balloon and blood transfusions. She was also she continues to have hypertension. And the day after the cesarean section, she had an HELLP syndrome. You can see the platelet, 50 here, and transaminase high, very high. So she had dexamethasone. And in the same day, in the morning, so the first day after cesarean section, she was still in the delivery room due to the hemorrhage. She had a saturation of 93%, so she had 6 liters per minute of oxygen, and she will join 98% of saturation. The temperature was normal, and then she joined 37.7, so not very high temperature. She was isolated. She had individual protection devices, and she had chest imaging where we can find an area of right lung inflammation. A first nasal pharyngeal swab was negative, and we had a day after the results. And we started with antibiotics therapy. We checked also for other virus, but all was negative, and also for bacteria, for example, Mycoplasma pneumonia, negative. And the day after, we performed, as advised from infectiologists, a second nasal swab. It was still negative. And we checked for chlamydia and streptococcus, but all was negative. This was the placenta. She had a retarded villus maturation with maternal vascular perfusion, fibrinoid deposition in the basal plate with severe chronic deciduities, as in host versus graft rejection, as in egg donation. So we can conclude that she had coronavirus. But in that week, we consider her as positive. What about placenta of patients with infection of coronavirus? That patients have showed in the placenta features of maternal vascular malperfusion. This is associated with oligohydramnios, fetal growth restriction, preterm birth. And so in that case, we have the same findings of coronavirus infection. So that's why for us, it was not so clear what we have to consider to do. And I really don't know if she had coronavirus because we didn't perform immunoglobulin. That's okay. I don't know if you have some questions. Yes, we test all women at 39 weeks of gestation. They came to our office to perform a cardiotocography in the last week of gestation, and we perform to the mother and to the partner. And if they will, if they arrive to the emergency room and they didn't, we perform the test in the emergency room. We treat as a positive. And for the partner, we wait the answer because now it is very fast. We have only the triage in the enter, so we check the temperature, and if they enter alone, no partner, and if the patient has symptoms, she's she cannot enter. If she has fever, she cannot enter. More than 37.5. You are welcome. No, surgical mask, only surgical mask, no FFP2. Adesso ogni mese, every 3 weeks. Ma adesso non stanno, ma guarda che stanno cambiando adesso, ogni mese vogliono farlo. I think they, no, till now every 3 weeks we have nasal swab in our hospital. I know from my colleagues that works in other hospital that they have one time every 2 weeks nasal swab and the third week the immunoglobulin. So it's not the same in all the hospitals. Now I think they want to change and check every month, but I don't know. See you later in 15 minutes.
Okay, and so we move on. Okay, and so thanks again to be with us today. And just a question, is some of you a pediatrician, or are you all obstetricians, or I don't know, anesthesiologists, and so a bad person? No, I joke, of course, very good person. We collaborate with them every day. No, is someone of you a pediatrician?
No, unfortunately, none of the pediatricians could join, but we will give them the videos of these lectures because they are very interested, but they couldn't really join.
Okay, and so I hope that the destiny of the newborns is in general also of interest for anesthesiologists and gynecologists. Okay, this is the table of contents. We will see what is the coronavirus. And so after we speak about the epidemiology, the mode of transmission, something is has been already presented before. And we will speak about the coronavirus in neonates. And we try to present what we did, what was our experience in Padua in our region. And finally, we summarize what we have said. Okay, this is a picture of the coronavirus as seen through an electron microscope. And where the coronavirus come from? Coronavirus come from the forest and on the jungle. They were in the bats, and there was a cross species transmission. They arrived to humans through the animal that were managed in live wet markets. And so for this animal in live wet markets, there was a zoonotic transmission to the human. Another question regards, is a question point, however, is if the virus arrived through other cross species transmissions, such as horse, camel, cattle, and so on. When the virus arrived to the human being, there is a community contact. And you know that we have a very large mass gathering, very large mobility. And this allowed a very fast spread of the virus around the world. At the beginning in China, the second part in general was Europe. We were the second one, in particular in Italy. Italy was the first country that was infected. And after the virus arrived in US, in particular in New York, but now is everywhere. I had some information from the south of the US, that is Florida, for example, is in this moment, the situation is very complicated. And you know that also in South America, in Brazil and other countries in South America, the infection is spreading and a lot of infected people have been interested. And so you have a community contact, or we have a contact from hospitalizing patients. And the transmission from here, from a infected hospitalized individual, could be spread to other patients in the hospital, in the same room, for example. And for us as health caregivers, there is a nosocomial transmission. And you know that a very delicate part of the chain of the transmission is the healthcare workers or healthcare workers. Another important aspect is the definition. We define the SARS, the severe acute respiratory syndrome coronavirus 2. When we speak about the SARS-CoV-2, we refer to the virus. When we speak about the COVID-19, it is referred to the disease. Before the outbreak originated in Wuhan, China, on December 2019, of course, you know better than me that there was not information about this virus and thought this was a new virus. From an epidemiological point of view, the virus or the infection started in the middle of December. There were the first cases reported in China, in Wuhan in particular, and the origin was the market, the wet market that we talked about before. And there was a peak of the infection between January and February in China. Later, as we told before, the virus spread everywhere, the infection spread everywhere. This is a very old, only 1 month ago, this is a slide, there were more than 6 million. I think now that we have more or less 12 or 15 million around the world, the cases, and so really a very, very spread infection. And more or less, we have 6% of deaths among the infected person. As we told you, the most interested country or continents are Europe and Americas. Here you can see the number of confirmed cases, COVID-19, over time. And as you can see here in Europe, we had the peak between March and April, while now the infection is spreading in Americas, the yellow line, while in Africa, in this moment, the situation is quite good. Only a few cases have been reported. There are a few hypotheses to try to explain why the virus was so little or limited, the spread of the infection was limited in Africa. In this slide, you can see the comparison between the seasonal flu and the COVID-19. The RO number is a very famous number and is referred to the estimate of how many people will be infected by one individual with the disease. If you have a flu, seasonal flu, you can infect 1.3 people, other people, individuals. If you have a COVID-19, the transmission is significantly higher. So the RO number is 2.5. The incubation time for the flu is 1 to 4 days, while is longer with the COVID-19, that is the trend from 1 to 14 days. It is the reason why we follow the person that had been contact, and the quarantine is at least of 2 weeks. The rate of the hospitalization rate also is very high, is almost 10 times higher with the COVID-19 patient compared to the flu, seasonal flu. And the case fatality rate also is significantly higher. We have 1.3.4 for the COVID-19 and 0.1 or less for the flu. The good information, or the good news for pediatrician is that the case fatality ratio is age linked. And so if you have, you know well that the older people have a significantly higher risk of death compared to the pediatric patient, pediatric population that is very low, more or less zero. And another important information is the previous health condition play an important role in the case fatality rate. If you have a cardiovascular disease or diabetes or respiratory disease, the risk of mortality is significantly higher. The sex also is important. Male seems to be more prone to die compared to female, but is for every kind of disease. The transmission of infection. For the transmission of infection, we can have a few modalities. The most important way of transmission is the droplets, become through the droplets. And you have here you have the infected individuals. You have the production of the droplets, and you infect the susceptible individuals. Another possibility is that we arrive in contact, in direct contact with the droplets by touching, for example, with our hands, or we can have indirect contact when we have the virus on the surfaces or where you have a high loading of virus. And in this case, we have an indirect contact. There is now a larger discussion around the world, around in particular around the WHO group, if there is a airborne transmission. The droplet transmission has been demonstrated. The airborne transmission means that you have a very small droplets, less than 5 micron mole diameter, that can travel in the air and can infect one individual through the airborne. It is not confirmed, but is under discussion this aspect of transmission. Of course, a neonatologist and obstetrician, and if you want, anesthesiologist, we are interested in vertical transmission. Does it exist? But in this study, the author reported that intrauterine infection is rare, is a rare viremia, less than 1% of all cases. Another important aspect for that is against the possibility of vertical transmission is the lack of receptor ACE2 on the placental cells. And so you know that the ACE receptor play an important role in the transmission infection. And so for this reason, rare viremia and lack of viral receptors, the placental infection seems to be unlucky, okay? And so congenital infection does not seem so well documented. This regards the intrauterine infection, and another possibility is the perinatal infection. 30% infected patients have a positive swab in the feces, and so we can find the virus in the feces. And during vaginal delivery, we can exposure to maternal secretion, respiratory secretion from the baby. And so two modalities, through the feces of the mother and through the contact or the respiratory secretion of the mother. This could be possible, and this could be another possibility to infect the baby. Now we say other aspects. When we try to identify an infection, we assess two aspects. The first is to look at the serology, okay? And if you look at the IgM, that is the antibody that does not cross the placenta. And so if you can find the IgM in the baby, it means that they are not from the mother, but they are produced from the baby. The sensitivity and the specificity of the IgM antibody assays is 70% to 88% for the sensitivity. The specificity is higher than 95%. The other way to look at the infection, so we say the serology, and the other way is to try to find the virus. And the virus in the infected patients could be found in 63% of the cases. If you take a broncholavage, the fluid from the broncholavage, you can find 93% of the positive broncholavage, and 30% in the feces. And so even a patient is infected, the RT-PCR testing could be negative. And so if, in particular, if you have a, you can try to find it, to look at it, at it in the faces or in the numbers or. Okay. Sorry, I was not clear. When you look at the infection, you look at IgM, and so the serology, and we look at the presence of the virus. To my knowledge, there are only a few papers, 3 papers, or maybe 4, that suggest the possible vertical transmission of SARS-CoV-2 from the infected mother to a newborn. This is the first case that has been reported in JAMA 2020, at the beginning of the pandemic. In this patient, as you can see here, the authors documented the presence of IgM, IgG, but they could be from the origin could be from the mother, because they crossed the placenta. In this case, however, they found the IgM. And so this is the first case that suggests the possible vertical transmission. Another study included 6 patients from 6 positive mothers, but the IgM was found positive only in 2 of them. This is the last patient that I show you, suggesting the possible transmission, the placenta transmission, the vertical transmission. This is a study published last week in Nature Communication. And here they reported, this group from France reported the presence of the viral load in the mother as well as in the neonates. But as you can see here, the viral load was found in the placenta, was found in the amniotic fluid, was found in the blood, umbilical blood, and so, and of course was found in the newborn, only 1 newborn, that clinically show neurological problems. He had convulsion and like in the adults, because some adults, apart from the respiratory distress, they can show also a neurological problem. And so these cases show that we can have the swab positive in the newborn. In this study, instead, they look at the 9 pregnant women. They look at the SARS-CoV-2 in amniotic fluid, in cord blood, in neonatal trough swab, in the breast milk sample, everywhere, but all of them were negative. And this study does not support the vertical transmission. This is the last study that I show you regarding the vertical transmission. And this study, it is a study, Italian study from Rome, and these authors, not his colleagues, show the presence of the SARS-CoV-2 RNA in the breast milk, in some sample of the breast milk, in the cord blood and the placenta tissue. And so in conclusion, what you can see from vertical transmission, the vertical transmission seems to be very unlikely. There are a lot of mother, positive mother, and only a few babies were found positive. So far, we have only 5 patients with IgM, positive IgM, or newborn with positive IgM immediately after birth, and only a few case reports where the author reported the positive swab of this patient. And so the vertical transmission seems to be possible, but very unlikely. Coronavirus in the neonates. The good news for neonatology is that in this cohort of more than 72,000 cases, only 1% of the patients, of the infected patient, aged less than 10 years. This is good information, but if you look at this another study, it is a study from including from China, including only pediatric cases, more than 2,000. We found that patients aged less than 1 year had the more severe and more critical illness. And so the disease is rare in the pediatric patient, but is more critical, even if the percentage remain very low in the group, in the smaller baby. This study concluded, the conclusion of this study were that clinical manifestation of PDT patients were generally less severe than those of adult patients. However, young children, particularly infants, were vulnerable to 2019 novel coronavirus infection. Why the newborns or the pediatric patient, the children are less have less severe symptoms compared to the adults? There are many hypotheses that support this clinical observation. There are differences in the immune system. There is a lower prevalence of comorbidities in the pediatric patient. There is a difference in ACE2 receptors, and there is also protection through off-target effect of BCZ vaccination. So there are a number of hypotheses, and you can find that this article that I found very interesting to try to explain why the children infected with SARS have less severe symptoms compared to the adults. In this study, we hope it will be accepted. Today we have the answer for the editor-in-chief. We try to summarize all the cases of the neonatal cases with COVID-19. We look at all the databases, and we found 25 studies that report case report or case series. In total, we found 40 in all the world, 44 neonatal cases with COVID-19. The quality of the study was limited, but now we look at what happened to these 44 patients. The most part of them, or the most part, 58% of them were males. The stationary baby were born at birth, at term. The weight was adequate. They had a very good APGAR score at 5 minutes. The most part of them were born from cesarean section, elective cesarean section, because we have to remember the most part of these patients, of these cases, are from China. And in China, cesarean section was an indication in patient, in a mother posing COVID positive mother. 28% of received breastfeeding, and a quarter of them were managed in the rooming room. The most part of them were diagnosed with a nasopharyngeal swab or throat or anal swab, and only three of them were diagnosed with by serology. 44 of them have a contact with infected mother, but a part of them did never have a contact with the mother. The age of diagnosis was 5 days. The age of the hospital admission average was 1 day, and 1/3 of them were admitted directly from home. And so they were discharged from the hospital, but when they were at home, they presented symptoms and they came back for and they were diagnosed to be infected. The most part of them were symptomatic, 68%. The most presented symptom was the fever, half of them. Gastrointestinal symptom was interest, a quarter of them. And so 20% present hypoxia, cold, and so on. The most part of them were managed with in a spontaneous breathing, room air, and so they didn't need any respiratory support, and 11% of them received mechanical ventilation. 28% received breastfeeding, the most part of them received formula, and 11% received pump milk. The conclusion of this review was that the most neonates with SARS-CoV-2 infection were asymptomatic or presented mild symptoms, generally were left in spontaneous breathing and had a good prognosis after a median 10 days of hospitalization. Experience in Padova. Padova is a city in the northeast of Italy. We are here. This is the Veneto region. And the first death due to COVID-19 in Italy occurred on February 21 in a small village. The name is Svo. This village is at 20 kilometers from Padua. And so you can imagine that we are very scared at that time. So At the beginning, we decide to opt for a protocol suggested or proposed by the Chinese expert consensus on neonatal, on perinatal management and neonatal management. I made the most part of you know this consensus. And so if you have a mother with confirmed or suspected COVID-19, if your baby is asymptomatic, the baby has to be put in quarantine, no contact with the mother, formula, and so on. If it's asymptomatic, of course, the baby has to be admitted to a single room in the NICU or in the dedicated room in the NICU. This was what we did at the beginning because we didn't know the enemy in this moment. We don't know what the virus, so we know that the virus, we knew that the virus was more aggressive, the mortality was high, and we have only information from China, but we didn't have too much information on the impact of the virus on the infection on the newborn. And so we adopted for a very aggressive management at the beginning. This is a study. I showed that I know that you receive you saw it before, and it is in New York during the phase when they had high prevalence disease. They organized a screening of all mother, and they found that the mother, the pregnant woman, mother who arrived at the delivery department, and they found that 15% of pregnant women were positive at admission. It is a very high percentage. But another important information from this study was that the most part of the mother, almost 90%, were asymptomatic at admission. And so the question is, if you give a look to this article, is do we need to do the screening to all the mothers to detect the mother that are positive but that are symptomatic? Why? Because we can isolate them, we can avoid the contact with the personnel, for example, with health caregivers, because if a caregiver becomes infected, the spread of the infection in the hospital is complicated. We try to look at I show you 15% here, in New York. Here we try to look at the prevalence of the incidence of infection in our region, in three Veneto area here, and we found only 15 mothers positive out of more than 7,000 deliveries, and so the incidence in our area was 0.2%, so very lower compared to 15% in New York. I think that you had already heard of this mother. She was the mother 25 weeks gestation. She arrived the baby was born on March 14. I want to speak only to present only the neonate. Neonate was 25 weeks. 800 grams, the mother received a general anesthesia, and we organized a cesarean section, elective cesarean section under general anesthesia due to the condition of the mother. The baby was intubated for depression, received surfactant. It was admitted to the NICU in negative pressure room. However, it was extubated and day two of life. After he received the second dose of surfactant, all the specimens in the baby were negative: nasopharyngeal, rectal, wasp, always negative. Also, the serology of this patient was negative. The baby received donor milk. Parental visit after 2 weeks. The parents were left in quarantine, and we allowed video visit. And the patient was discharged in very good condition. The diagnosis was prematurity, RDS, PDA, a late onset sepsis. But the course, based also on the gestational age, the course and the weight at birth was very good for this patient. And so we tried to prepare, at the beginning, we tried to prepare, we published this protocol. We divided the delivery pathway into its phase, before, during, and after. Before, what we have to do before, we need to do the protocol, to have a specific protocol. For example, the protocol has to define the paths, where the patient go, where the, this is a path in a Tosa Maganga hospital in Tanzania, where we are collaboration with. And so, as you can see here, there is a dressing room. The midwife or the nurses can enter only specific places. The mother can arrive only at a specific path. This is an dressing room. It is just to give you an example of how can you organize COVID and not COVID paths in your hospital. The spatial distances is also very important. And so it is very, when the mothers arrive in the natal care, they have to maintain the spatial distance of at least 1 meter. And the healthcare workers have to wear the correct PPE, medical mask, air protection, and gloves. Possibly we try to organize the waiting area in open, well-ventilated area. And hand hygiene is very important. Also, you can use alcoholic solution. This is an example of the spatial distancing in Tanzania. And this is another example in another hospital in Uganda, where we are collaborating with them. Matani Hospital is the name of this hospital. And here you can see that the distance, the spatial distancing, distance was tried to be organized in a well-ventilated space. When a mother arrives at the hospital, you have to organize the triage and the screening. Before my colleagues spoke about the triage, the mother have to maintain the spatial distancing. They have to wear the mask. In Italy, we are obliged to use the mask when we go to the hospital, but also when we go in the street, if you have a street contact with other patients, with other persons. The triage is based on the contact history, the presence of fever, or the presence of influence-like illness. In this case, in this hospital, we organize nasopharyngeal throat swab for viral RNA. This was what we did at the beginning. Now what we do is that when a mother arrives, they ask to maintain the spatial distancing. We do the triage, we collect we measure the fever, the temperature, and all the mothers arriving and the father arriving in our hospital receive a nasopharyngeal and throat swab. Second point was how to organize during the delivery. During delivery, you have to, this article we tried to, it is an article that we wrote with our colleague from US and the colleague from Spain. And the delivery and the operating room has to be organized in possibly a negative pressure room, if you can. The operator the healthcare giver has to wear the correct PPE. Goggles, mask, bone, gloves. We didn't invite the partner in the labor room at the beginning because we when a mother was positive or were suspected, and so the father was contacted only with a virtual interaction. So the mother during the labor could have a contact with the partner only in a virtual modality. The delayed cord clamping is still maintained, and so we continue to do delayed cord clamping, but we avoid in the suspected or positive mother the skin-to-skin contact. Another important point in our protocol is to reduce the number of providers in the room. And so if you have based on the amount of job or the amount of the care needed for the mother, for the baby, you have to limit the operators in the room to avoid the contact. For example, in our hospital, we have an additional provider outside the room for backup. And so if the baby need resuscitation, we are outside of the room and we enter with our transport incubator in case the baby need resuscitation. Already before, it has been said that the modality of cesarean of delivery remain the vaginal delivery, and so this is based on obstetric indication as always. And so if you have a vaginal delivery, we have already spoken, and so the delayed cord clamping is lower. If you decide, if the obstetrician decide for cesarean section, the preferred way is the modality is spinal or epidural anesthesia. General anesthesia has to be limited to mother with severe COVID-19, with severe pneumonia and severe RDS. To my knowledge, in our hospital, we had two mothers with severe pneumonia or RDS that were managed in general anesthesia, but the other mothers were managed of the spinal anesthesia or vaginal delivery. Where to do the resuscitation? Resuscitation can be done in another room, and so the mother is here, and you have another room, you take the baby, you put the baby and the team in another room to avoid the contact with the mother. Or the other possibility is to do the resuscitation in the same room where the mother is delivering. And the important is to maintain the spatial distance of at least 2 meters, and you can add a barrier between the neonatologist and the mother. After the delivery, what do you have to do? After delivery, one of the most important decisions is what is the nutrition to give, which kind of milk to give to the baby. This is a decision that need to be shared with parents and need to be shared and discussed with the father. The decision has to be taken with them. And you have 3 possible scenarios. You can decide to be like the China approach, formula and donor milk. And so the mother does not give the proper milk to the baby, and the mother pump and discharge express a baby milk, okay? And so this is the first possibility. This is the based on the Chinese expert consensus. The second possibility is to clean the breast, express milk with precaution, and a health caregiver can give the milk, the maternal milk, to the baby in a separate room. This is the supported modality from American College of Obstetrics and Gynecology and CDC of Atlanta at the beginning. And the third scenario is to allow the mother to breast the baby, but you have to educate the mother for cleaning the breast and for cleaning the hands very well. And so cleaning rules are very important in this case. The mother in this case has to wear, of course, a mask. This is the modality suggested by WHO, UNICEF, and also Italian consensus. Now, at the beginning, we gave formula or donor milk. Now we are in this position in Italy. One of the last thing to do is the discharge of the patient. And you have also in this case 2 possibilities. You have a mother positive and a baby negative. In the case the baby and the mother can be discharged, but please ask to the mother to limit the contact with the baby. And so someone different in the family, different, that is negative, of course, different from the mother, can take care of the baby. The baby needs to be retested in 2-3 weeks. The second possibility is to have a mother and a baby that are both asymptomatic and both positive. In this case, you can discharge the baby with the mother. And in this case, you have to give information to the mother on prevention of the transmission. So the mother has to use the, to clean the breast, to clean the hands, and to wear the mask. It is very important to maintain a close follow-up of the mother in infants, for example, through video or phone calls. Another important aspect when you discharge a baby is to educate the family on the possible clinical sign of late onset neonatal COVID-19. And so the baby has a loss of interest in feed, nasal congestion flaring, apnea, lethargy, cyanosis, respiratory distance, temperature instability, diarrhea is another important. I show you that a quarter of neonatal cases has had diarrhea. Last part is dedicated to COVID and neonatal transfer. We, in our institution, cover a large area, including 5 provinces, 23 hospitals, more than 20,000 delivery. And in this case, we say, okay, in our hospital, we are well organized, but how can we do when we receive a call for a transfer of the baby in another hospital? And so we organize this protocol that we published recently. And so we received the call phone from the phone call from the Spoke Hospital. Here we do the triage, a specific triage on COVID. If the triage on COVID is negative, we transport as usual. If the COVID, the triage based on COVID is positive, the team has to wear specific PPE. We arrive to the hospital. We avoid to enter in emergency department where we can have an infected person. We have decided with the local hospital specific clean pathway to arrive in the delivery room, neonatal ward. We stabilize the patient and we come back to the hub hospital COVID-19 center. This is the self-assessment during the triage when we receive the phone. This is our team who arrive in a hospital where they have a suspected mother. And so in this case, as you can see, you have to wear complete PPE. In conclusion, children and neonates are less affected by SARS-CoV-2 infection than adults. Some hypotheses have been suggested, but the reason remains unclear. Most neonates with SARS-CoV-2 infection are asymptomatic or present mild symptoms and have a good prognosis. Only 10% of them have to be intubated, but the prognosis is good and no deaths have been reported for neonatal cases. Safety of healthcare providers caring for mother neonate is crucial, and so be careful when you have a contact with a suspected or infected mother or infected baby. It is very important to avoid the hospital transmission in this case. Mother and child contact and breastfeeding are reasonable, and so we can support the breastfeeding, but need caution and counseling with the family. Okay, and so please present the risk and the positive aspect to the mother and to the family to decide if to maintain the baby in the same room and to support the breastfeeding. Local protocols regarding, for example, the correct paths, the correct use of PPE, how many staff members have to be in the room, and you need a rescue personnel for emergency situation. The cleaning procedures are very important. So local protocols are mandatory to guide healthcare staff and families. And another aspect very important that is emerging, we discovered in this last month, is that psychological support for staff and families should be considered. Thank you for your attention. I don't know if you have some questions or whatever.
We really thank you very much for this. We have learned so many practical things, like the idea of transport, how we should organize that, the triage for transport, the personnel that should be prepared outside the room just in case the baby needs resuscitation, and so many, many, many useful things. And we now come to have more and more cases. We had about 1,000 cases confirmed today. This means that out there are many other cases. So it's very, very useful. Again, I apologize for not having neonatologists and anesthesiologists, but I can assure you that these presentations will be given to them to watch in their free time, and they will learn the important points. I congratulate you honestly for your huge amount of publications. We are very grateful that we have your and your colleagues as well, your input on this. If I may have an academic-like question now.
Yeah.
Any thoughts about what happens to preterm babies if they are exposed? Are there any other supplementary risks other than the RDS that they, is there any caution that we should take if the baby is a preterm baby, severely, very low birth weight, let's say below 28 weeks, if they are exposed to a COVID, I don't know, medical staff or mother or any things that we should, is there any evidence that they are doing the same or worse than usual?
Thanks for your comments in general, and so thanks for your question. The management of this baby is the same from the filter babies, of course, regarding the infection. Of course, if you are extremely low birth weight infants, the risk of infection is significantly higher in general. But with COVID-19, there are very, very few cases that have been reported. In Italy, we reported the only very, very low birth weight infants that was the patient that I show you, that I presented you, is 25 weeks gestation, weeks gestation. But in general, I show you that the average gestational age is 39. If you have a baby, a small baby, or very preterm baby, born from two infected mothers or suspected mother, the management is the same. We have not special, drugs or also in our patient, I was on duty, unfortunately, that night. And so we gave sulfata with a very good response at the beginning, and he needed the second dose because we have not time to give steroids, antenatal steroids, because there was a discussion, the steroids has a negative effect on the mother, on the clinical condition of the mother, but now also this aspect is has been ruled out. And so, yes, convince obstetrician to give, or anesthesiologist, that take care of the mother, infected mother, so symptomatic mother. I understand that they can be worried of the clinical condition, but antenatal steroids should be, however, given to the mother for prevention of all the complications, not only RDS, but also IVH and other complications of the prematurity.
Thank you. I have read some studies that actually those treated with dexamethasone, those patients outside pregnancy, we don't know for pregnancy, but those treated with dexamethasone, they actually do better. So, you know, it has been the antivirals, hydroxychloroquine, and now is the dexamethasone. I don't know what's the conclusion of that, but they say they do better. The last question from my side would be if you have any thoughts on how these babies infected so early on in their lives would do in terms of lung function later on in life. Do you think there are possible complications like lung fibrosis, or as we discuss in adults, we don't know, so far we don't know for adults, but what about these babies? Do you have any thoughts on that?
No, it is a very, very clever question. And so I like your knowledge and how you present this question. No, we know that pneumologists say that the prognosis of the lung is worse for the adults. And we know it. And you know well that in particular, for the newborn, the prognosis or the outcome of the pulmonary outcome could be complicated. We say only bronchopulmonary dysplasia. But really, we have not enough cases to support this. I show you that for the 44 newborn infants that have been reported so far, only 10%, 11% of them receive intubation. That means that the symptoms were very mild, very mild. I don't know if the long-term outcome is different. It is not possible to know now. And so it is important to follow this patient. But I think that, for example, our preterm newborns did not develop bronchopulmonary dysplasia. It is not, in general, if you was born at 25 weeks, you have the bronchopulmonary dysplasia. But in this case, for example, where the mother was symptomatic, severely symptomatic, and the baby did not receive antenatal steroids, and she was born for general anesthesia. So all the prognosis was terrible for this baby. Despite this prognostic negative aspect, this patient did not I know that we are a good neonatologist. No, it was just, we were just lucky, but we need more casuistics to answer to your interesting question.
Thank you very, 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 very much for this. Really, thank you. I'm very grateful and it's really useful to us. Again, we will get these recordings and give them to our neonatologists, anesthesiologists, and who also needs to have this input. Thank you again for your time and for preparing these great lectures for us. Thank you very, very, very much. Very grateful.
You are very kind. You are very kind. We are also happy to share our problems with you and with your staff.
Thank you very much to everybody. See you on Thursday. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Linka. Bye. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.
See you.
Thank you. See you.
See you soon.